Anyone know, anyone recognize them at all? These are, how many, it's seven surviving women who qualified for spaceflight in 1962, but never got to fly because it was 1962. Has anyone ever heard of the Mercury 13 before? Show of hands. Wow, like no one. Okay, awesome sauce. We'll learn. Let's dive in. But before we get into women that didn't fly in space, we have to take a step back and look at what's, who decided who was going to fly in space in the first place. So in the 1950s, in like the mid-1950s, this was what the future of space was going to look like. It was going to be big and futuristic and probably have like a Disney sheen to it. It was going to be big and exciting. And there were a few nations that were excited to do it, namely the United States and the Soviet Union, which were, of course, at war in the Cold War. Do you guys, students here, do you guys learn about the Cold War still? Okay, good, because I've done this talk and people are like, what was the Cold War? I'm just like, ooh. Anyways, so this was the shiny future in space that we thought we were going to get. And then that all kind of went down the drain when the Soviet Union launched history's first ever satellite, Sputnik, on October 4th of 1957. So this was the future we thought we would get. This was the reality. It's not the same, right? Sputnik is a ball, 184 pounds, it beeped, and it scared the crap out of the United States. Even though it couldn't do anything but beep. Beeping is not scary. It depends on what the beep is, I guess. Anyways, but it did excite a whole bunch of weirdo nerds. Namely, the people that wanted to send humans into space, because now, not only was space a thing that we could get up to, it meant that there could be a future in it that was not going to be like, oh, you're a crazy weirdo, let's go to space. No, oh, you want to go to space, let's do it. Then the Soviet Union upped the ante. A month later, on November 3rd of 1957, launched Sputnik 2 with Laika, the dog, on board. Now, it wasn't a really big deal that there was a dog on board. The big deal was that the dog had a life support system. Sputnik 2 was also 1,000 pounds heavier than Sputnik 1. That meant their rockets were more powerful, and they were clearly looking at sending a human into orbit. So what does the United States do? It responds by creating the NASA we know and some of us love today. And NASA was designed to like make space exciting and for the humans and all this good stuff, but really unofficially, it existed purely to put an American in space before the Soviet Union put up one of their guys. So then the question is, who's the person that's going to go into space? Well, think about what space means. Like no one had any idea what spaceflight was going to be. So they looked at people like contortionists, like acrobats, like divers, like people who dealt with fire, basically anybody who wouldn't mind being in a cramped, awful situation and at death's door and like be fine about it, which is insane. But then they got to thinking, okay, well maybe because it's a new vehicle, they should be engineers who can actually deal with new, untested vehicles in real time without losing their cool in a bad situation. And that job just happened to exist in the form of test pilots. So then NASA starts looking at test pilots, and it's President Eisenhower in 1958 who says, I want them to be military-trained jet pilots. Not because that was a particular skill set that they wanted, it would probably be useful, but because if they were in the military, they had clearance. Even though NASA is a civilian administration, civilian agency, there was going to be something because it was still an outlet of the Cold War. It would be really good if these guys had the clearance just in case they needed it. So military test pilots at the time in 1959 meant men. And these men had to be, by virtue of the very small spacecraft, I love this picture because you can see just how small the vehicle is next to the guy working on it, right? This thing's tiny. By virtue of the size, they had to be shorter than 5'11" because otherwise they wouldn't be able to get inside. Weigh less than 180 pounds, because otherwise the rocket wouldn't be able to get off the ground, and have all kinds of qualifications like jet flying time and bachelor's degrees. So they go through all these things, 110 men qualify for the basics, 36 go through extensive and invasive medical testing, and these seven emerge as the victorious national heroes, the nation's Mercury astronauts, announced on April 9th of 1959. Now, the guy who helped select them was this guy, Dr. William Lovelace. He did all the physical testing of what would make the perfect human specimen to fly in space, as nobody really knew what spaceflight was going to demand. But he thought maybe he didn't make the right choices with these guys. He thought maybe it would actually be better to have women in the cockpit, because women are smaller, they're lighter, they consume fewer resources, and there was research to suggest that women are better at doing monotonous tasks and dealing with extended isolation, probably because a housewife is not necessarily the most exciting job occupation. And women also made really good pilots. He knew this. Case in point, Jerry Cobb. Jerry Cobb held, in 1959, dozens of international flight records, distance, speed, altitude. She'd been awarded from International Aeronautical Federation's Golden Wings. She was, by all accounts, an absolute ace pilot, holding court with everyone else in her field. And she just happened to meet Dr. Lovelace on a beach in September of 1959. Beautiful, right? They get to talking. She starts talking about planes, and he's like, oh, you're a pilot? And she says, yes. And then someone she's with is like, actually, she's like an incredible pilot with 7,000 hours. You should really talk. So they get to talking, and he's like, so do you want to train for space? And she's like, yes. So between February of 1960, she starts going through the exact same medical and physical testing that all the Mercury male astronauts went through. And not only does she pass every test, she scores higher than the men almost across the board. And she's pretty excited, and Lovelace is like totally stoked. But for him, it's like an academic interest. So he holds her results until a medical conference in October of 1960 and quietly announces it. And the world kind of goes nuts because all of a sudden there's this woman who is singularly just as good as these seven national heroes combined. And everyone wants a piece of her. Like Sports Illustrated wants her, Life profiles her. Like she's getting sponsorship deals from cigarette companies because it's 1960. But she wants none of it. She just wants to push her career to the next level. And for a woman who's flown every kind of plane you can have all over the world, the next level is literally space. So Lovelace is really excited about Cobb, but he needs to make sure that she's not just some like weird anomaly superwoman who was bit by a radioactive spider. I'm sorry, I just mixed up my comic book heroes, but I'm not that much of a comic book person. So he and Cobb work together to recruit another 24 women to go through the exact same testing. They start in early May of early 1961. 12 of them pass all the physical testing. And just like Cobb, they either do as well as the men or better than the men across the board. They're clearly up to the task. And in May 17th of 1961, he invites them to go through the second phase of testing, which is the psychological testing. Now, Cobb has done this as well. She passed. This is things like isolation chambers to see how you deal with, you know, absolute sensory deprivation. Cobb, at this point, is even going through the third phase of testing at the Navy's lab in Pensacola, which includes things like sticking needles in your brain and flying zero-G in a jet for an EEG. Because science, I actually don't get that one, but that's a thing that she had to do, and she did it, and she passed. But the date, that date might spark any thoughts in anyone's mind, May 17th, 1961. Well, there was a lot of other things happening in space around the time that these women were going through their testing. Oh, I forgot about Jackie Cochran. But the other thing, okay, well, let's back up to these women. So the other problem for women, don't get leave from work to go test for astronaut training, right? Women don't get time off. Women don't get their travel paid for. They have to take time off. They have to quit their jobs. They have to leave their families at home. And they all could do this with the help of their guardian angel in the form of Jackie Cochran, who was an ace pilot, like world-renowned. She led a group called the Women's Auxiliary Service Pilots in the Second World War. These were women who flew all the dirty jobs that men didn't want to do, and she loved it because she was in charge of thousands of female pilots, and they all reported to her, and it made her a pretty famous pilot. So these women are all getting funded by Jackie Cochran, who's basically trying to be the guardian angel to these women to take control over them, because she wants to be in charge of the women's astronaut program. Jerry Cobb wants to be the first woman in space because she just wants to see a woman in space. She's qualified. Why can't she start to train? But that date that I pointed out, May 17th, 1961, well, a lot of things were going on in space. NASA is working in early 1961 to get a first man in space. This is Gus Grissom, John Glenn, Al Shepard. One of them is going to be up first. One of them is going to be the first human in space. And then Yuri Gagarin beats them all to it, right? So the Soviets, Sputnik, Sputnik 2, Yuri Gagarin, they're winning, hands down. So April 12, 1961, he's the first man in orbit. And 3 days later, let's add the failed Bay of Pigs event slash disaster into that. We've got a young President Kennedy just being beaten in space, just had the failed Bay of Pigs invasion. He sees space as this thing that he can leverage into saving his reputation and really putting himself back, putting the US back on par with the Soviet Union. And so he decides to go to the moon. It's kind of nutty when you think about it, but he decides that we're going to go to the moon. On May 25th of 1961, he promises the nation a moon landing by the end of the decade. At this point, Jerry Cobb is becoming a bit of a pain in NASA's butt, because she is just campaigning, giving talks, using her position that people know who she is to really put pressure on NASA to let her fly in space. What she wants is to just work in the flight rotation like any pilot would. Train alongside the men, just jump on a mission, and just be the first woman in space, because the Soviets are doing everything first. Let's get a first for America with the first woman in space. To shut her up, NASA makes her an official consultant on the role of women in space on May 26th of 1961. And she very quickly finds herself, in her words, the least consulted consultant of all time. But she really got excited about this. She was trying to use this to build up her position, to build up her argument, and to really get the other women that were training, going through all their qualifications, to give them a voice and give them a chance of flying in space. Then in September 12th of 1961, here's two of the other women that were training. September 12th of 1961, just months later, Cobb gets a telegram from Dr. Lovelace saying that the women's final phase of testing at Pensacola, Florida, at the Navy lab, is canceled. He doesn't know why. He can't give her any answers. He's upset. And Jerry Cobb just kind of loses it. And she goes to Washington, and she starts knocking on doors at NASA's administration, at everybody politically she can get her hands on to figure out why their testing has suddenly been canceled. They've been going at it for almost, she's been in this for 2 years now. No one will give her a straight answer. NASA says it hadn't actually ordered the testing, so couldn't do it. The Navy says that without an official NASA order, it can't give up the space and the time for the women's testing. It's basically a bureaucratic game of pass the buck. No one wants to acknowledge that they canceled this and destroyed the hopes of these women. And everybody is just kind of saying, like, no, just go over there. You're fine. Don't worry about it. No one's giving her a straight answer. But NASA presses forward because now, right, it's trying to get to the moon. And Cobb is trying to get answers out of NASA. NASA's a little bit more focused on this guy right here. On February 2nd, 1962, John Glenn finally goes into orbit. And Jerry Cobb is still fighting the good fight, trying to get people to listen to her about the rationale to put women in space, trying to just get her own place. We've got a man up first, great, now let's get a woman up. That's basically what she's trying to get across everywhere. Doesn't work. This all comes to a head. She has been enough of a pain in the butt that NASA says, all right, you get a Senate hearing. Between July 17th and 19th, 1962, there's a 3-day Senate hearing for a special subcommittee on the qualifications of NASA astronauts. That's how it is in the books. Unofficially, it's to see if NASA is unduly discriminating against women. On the women's side, here's Jerry Cobb and another one of the women astronaut trainees, Janie Hart and Jackie Cochran. Cobb's would be basically nemesis. On NASA's side is John Glenn, the first man in orbit, Scott Carpenter, the second man in orbit, and George Lowe, the man who picked the first man in orbit. So we've got some pretty strong sides developing here. Over the course of this Senate hearing, the transcript is insane. Jerry Cobb again pleads her case and says, I am just as qualified as these men. Make an exception. I was not in the military. I cannot be a jet pilot. A spacecraft is not a jet. Why can't I learn to fly it the same way the men have? And Janie Hart saying the same thing. Janie Hart had 8 kids, and she put all that on hold to train to be an astronaut. Why should I not get my chance to fly alongside the men and be a national hero and stand up for my country? Then Jackie Cochran takes the stand and says, she goes to her experience with the WASPs in the Second World War and says, so I trained all these women to fly in the Second World War, and they were great. They had a better safety rating than all the men. But then they got married and left. So why would you waste money training women to fly in space if you're just going to lose them through marriage? That's actually what a woman who, by the way, only learned to fly because her husband said, darling, why don't you learn to fly? She actually said that in a Senate hearing. And of course, NASA towed the exact same line. NASA's official ruling was that it would cost time and money to put women in simulators that they needed to train the Mercury astronauts for their missions, and that was more important. that any women's training program would just divert resources and funding and attention that NASA needed to get men in space, learn how to live and work in space, and eventually get them to the moon. Because what do you think is going to be more important for NASA? A woman in space or a man on the moon? Shout it out. Moon, obviously. Moon is greater than woman. So the hearing is cut short a day early after 2 days. First day is women, second day is NASA, third day is cut. Cobb is just shocked. She was not warned that this was going to happen, and she still does not give up her fight. She keeps going. She keeps appearing on talk shows, in magazines. She publishes her first memoirs to try to bring just a few more eyes on her case to put more pressure onto NASA. She still thinks that she needs to be there. A woman needs to go into space first from America, then the Soviet Union. And the same month that her memoirs are published, Valentina Tereshkova flies in space. June 16th, 1963, and Tereshkova is always pointed to as a woman who was, you know, a beacon of feminine, or no, she was a political move, hey, like full on, that's a whole other story, but still, it was a final blow for Cobb that she not only had, she wanted to do for the United States what Tereshkova did for the Soviet Union, and nobody would listen to her. She ended up leaving the country and flying as a missionary in South America for the rest of the decade. So Cobb's story is not necessarily the best one, because this woman gave her life to flying. She gave up flying to try to fly in space, and when that didn't work, she left the country. But the most incredible part of her story, I think, is the fact that she fought as hard as she did for something that she believed in, even though she didn't have a guarantee. If you think about how hard it was in the 1940s and 50s for a woman to get a job flying, the jobs she took were the jobs that a man didn't want, which meant they were dangerous and scary and like horrifying, but it meant she could fly. And when she gave all that up and she put everything on the line, she had a horrible stutter, she hated public speaking, but she stood up in a Senate hearing to give herself and the women that she worked with a fighting chance to actually fly in space. Even though she never flew in space, the fight that she waged, I know we're supposed to be talking about curiosity, but I'm gonna talk about strength, because the strength that it took for her to put everything she had on the line, time and time again, for what she wanted to achieve with her life and what she believed in, I think is a lesson that everyone should be able to take and apply into their own lives. Thank you.